Now, we are talking about something else. We are talking about Britain, racism, money, culture, and politics. You know that the grandchild of the one of the world's longest-serving monarchs, I think she is, the Queen of England, Queen Elizabeth, his grandchild is Prince Harry. He and his wife have left the royal family. But last week, they gave an explosive interview to the famous media mogul in America, Oprah Winfrey. And it was reported by Prince Harry's wife that there were concerns about the color of the skin of her son. You know that she is a black woman, and there were a lot of issues around the wedding. Tonight, we are discussing that with an all-female panelist, two journalists, one banker, social commentator, one barrister, to tell us how we see it in this country. People have said that it's not our matter, Ghana, we are hungry, and you're going to talk about all of these. It's just wannabeism. Okay, so we'll start with that one, but we need to look at it because racism affects us. It would affect your children when they travel. It will affect me when I travel. It will affect the Europeans who come here to work with us. We're talking about trade. We're talking about global trade. We can't do trade when there's racism. It has to be stamped out if indeed there is, and we'll be looking at that tonight. So those are the themes we'll be looking at: racism, culture, politics, money. Yes, money. And also royalty. That's our story for tonight, coming up.
Princess Diana embroiled in more controversy as she pulls out of a meeting with MPs.
Princess Diana moved today to patch up her relations with the former royal nanny.
Princess Diana flew to Milan today for the memorial service for the murdered Italian fashion designer Gianni Versace.
Where tonight, another royal controversy sparkles.
After finding herself embroiled in her second controversy this week.
I am not a political figure.
Princess Diana sailed out into the Mediterranean in one of Mr. Mohammed Al-Fayed's yachts today.
With his son.
£250,000 for photographs, which appear to show the couple embracing. Once again, her judgments under scrutiny.
Bridget, people think we shouldn't even be talking about this because it's not our matter. It's Obroni matter, and we are just wannabes.
Right. No, I'm not surprised. I'm not surprised because I see the comments every time issues about racism comes up. I see people write that, oh, they wish the white people were still ruling us because we would have things different. It's also because a lot of those people may never travel abroad, but they will have family members who travel abroad. And the reason why it's important is because you're discriminated against, not because of the content of your character, but the color of your skin. And it's important that we talk about it also because people really play down the tragedy, that they play down the impact of slavery on us. They don't know all of this is rooted in that. And so it's important because the more you talk about it, people are aware of it. You're seeing that George Floyd was killed because of how he looked and not because of anything else. So when you talk about it and people get to hear about it, perhaps it's, I hope that it changes minds of people in Ghana who think that it's far from us, because
but
really
what's,
it's not.
What's racism about what happened?
About what happened?
Yes, is it racism?
Oh, absolutely. Everything has got everything to do with it. I mean, Meghan Markle is an independent woman. Mm-hmm. She was very opinionated. She loved women, even at a very young age of 11, she already knew her place in society. I think it was the pots and pans. She saw an advert on television that says that women in America are all using greasy pots and pans, and she felt it wasn't right. So she writes to the company, and the company changes it and makes it people in America. In other words, she's changing the narrative about women's place in the kitchen. So, and then she leaves all of this independence and say, I'm in love with a prince. And the only thing they ask of the royal family is security and protection. But what do we see? The very things that Kate Middleton will do and get praise, she does and gets criticism.
Conversations with Harry about it, and have your own suspicions as to why they didn't want to make Archie a prince. What are those thoughts? Why do you think that is? Do you think it's because of his race? And I know that's a loaded question, but...
But I can give you an honest answer. In those months when I was pregnant, all around this same time, so we have in tandem the conversation of He won't be given security. He's not going to be given a title. And also concerns and conversations about how dark his skin might be when he's born.
What?
And
who is having that conversation with you? What?
So,
there is a conversation. Hold up.
There are several conversations.
There's a conversation with you.
With Harry.
About how dark your baby is going to be?
Potentially, and what that would mean or look like.
Ooh. And you're not going to tell me who had the conversation?
I think that would be very damaging to them.
Okay. Felicity, you're on the floor. And you were saying there's racism in England, even though I don't know about it.
Just because you don't know about something doesn't mean it's not happening. Mm-hmm, I think we need to clarify that. And even if I had never experienced racism, that would never in any way mean that racism doesn't happen.
Have you experienced it?
In my probably once.
How
I was
like
on the bus when I was probably about 14 and some random two drunk men came on the bus like, "Oh, you niggers." But
that's racism.
Someone calling you a nigger, yes, that is a racial term and extremely rude. And the word nigger has such strong connotations. Come on, Paul.
So if I call you nigger, that's rude. Or if you call me nigger.
Well, black people at this moment have reclaimed the word. So there's lots of black people who do use the word nigger amongst each other, and it's not offensive.
Okay, you were making the important point that we all say that Meghan Markle should have known, and you don't understand.
People keep saying you should have known what you're getting yourself into. What exactly was she getting herself into? She fell in love with someone. Yes, there's a 1,200 institution around that person that she's falling in love with, but what should she have known that when she gets into that house and she's feeling isolated and she wants to seek mental health support, and they say no, you can't do that because royals can't do that. Is this something that she could have Googled to find out? Is this information that you could easily access? How much do we actually even really know about what happens in that household that we keep saying she should have known what she was getting herself into? And let's say she didn't know, and then she gets into that situation and recognizing that this isn't for me. We should have a society which is accepting of people getting into situations and thinking they have some knowledge, and then getting into it and realizing, you know what, this is actually not for me. And they should be able to step away without us judging them for saying, well, you got into it, so you should stick with it. I know something isn't good for me, but I must stick with it because I made a bad decision. I don't keep intentionally keep carrying on with a bad decision when I've recognized at some point that was a bad decision.
And I spoke to a professor of social science today, and she was saying that, because I told her what you're just saying, that as far as I'm concerned, I don't really get the racism question, because...
That's what you're worth.
I mean, I, when I go to London and something happens and somebody tells me that, the person I'm with tells me that, look, they're being racist, so I enter a shop, I say I want to buy a tie, and they're repeating the price of the tie. I don't even know that it's racism.
Because
I just
Paul,
hurry up and
because, Paul,
pay.
Your reality is different.
Yes. That's what she said. That's what I was coming
I remember
to.
I was asked this question on WPR in Wisconsin. That, oh, how did they treat you? And I said, I'm sorry. I cannot use 6 weeks in America to judge racism because I'm going to be treated different. But somebody else was born there, grows up there, goes through the system, experiences it. So they would know.
Yeah, so they tell me that the reason why they are repeating the price of the tie is because they think you cannot pay.
Yeah,
they think you cannot afford. I don't know.
Yeah.
So they said but you thought it was for clarity?
Yeah, something.
Why should you go to the shop and feel bad about yourself? Yeah, they're trying to make you feel bad about yourself.
It is X pounds.
Yes.
Yeah. And I said, okay, give me two.
Yeah.
And the guy said, did you see the foolishness of the girl?
Yeah.
I said, what did she
do? Why should your experience be ruined? You should be focused on the tie
and
buying it.
Exactly.
They want to ruin your experience because they can't afford it.
So for me, I don't see that as racism, but somebody tells me.
But
this professor was telling me that there's structural racism that doesn't even allow people to have the education to create their own world. What you're talking about? They don't even have the education.
You can create your own world by going online. You know,
online is still much further departure from them.
Okay, you know,
from the people in Brixton,
from
the people in Brixton,
the
people in the Queens in New York.
Okay, who's that black guy who's a doctor that was running for president in America? What's his name? He became part of Trump's administration.
Yes. So he became a great minister.
Ben Carson wrote a book, but he spoke about his book quite a lot.
Yeah.
It was very interesting. He grew up in the ghetto, like ghetto proper.
Oh, he did.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Very interesting story. And so you know what he did? For some reason, he just started getting, he started liking classical music. Mm-hmm. So he would listen to a lot of classical music, and he would create his own environment, even though he was poor, even though he was black, even though, you know, the chances of him, you know, rising, etc., etc. But he liked classical music, etc., etc., and he created his own world. And eventually, he became a medical doctor. And then when he was going for residency, this is a very important story, when he was going for residency, the person who was going to be with him for like, you know, 12 hours at a time, you know, doing these sort of operations, was vetting who he should pick. And he just happened to pick him because he could talk about everything he wanted to talk about, like with about classical music. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So the point is, people care more about how they feel next to you, bottom line. And please, you seem to be a Brit, and so am I. I'm Ghanaian, and I'm British as well. So I've lived in England for over 20 years of my life. Mm-hmm. Do you see what I mean? So it's not like I don't see. But my point is, I will never allow someone to reduce my experience by me focusing on them.
Let me come in here.
I think that
privilege.
That's the point.
As a lawyer,
call to the English bar.
That's privilege. That's a privilege. Your experience, you do not speak. You do not. Your experience is not similar to the girl who has been brought up in Brixton.
Correct.
You do not have her lived experience
at all.
But you know what I have? And for you to be one of the few women and black women,
that they will come against me even harder.
I've been called to the bar. The fact that few black women, that's what shows how hard it is. How easy is it to even get into an inn? How easy is it for black people?
You know why
people?
You're wrong?
No, but no. Why
the higher people fly.
How many black women, black people go into Oxford, get into
You know Cambridge? Why you're wrong?
They're not, these things you're are wrong. Structurally set up. That's why schools like Cambridge have to literally set up scholarships to recruit black people to ensure they start getting to go into the, no. into the, in, this, in the city.
No, she's right.
Intercity secondary school to start building these students up to get to a set, but those students don't go to the private schools. They don't have a certain level of education.
So I couldn't possibly have earned my way.
When you're a privileged black woman, you have to recognize
that. I couldn't have earned my way. I couldn't have earned my way.
Like the Brits, can the Brits hold on for a bit and then.
It's because they are lazy. They should not allow anybody. Sometimes they can go for certain jobs and they're rejected simply because they're black. And there's nothing they can do about it. You know, they can push all they want. They can get the grades. They can go to the schools and still will not get certain opportunities.
But this is why she disagrees with you. You go to the school, you get called to the bar.
No,
she got called to the bar.
And then I went where you called to the bar.
And you went hard.
And
she
went
hard.
Don't get called to the bar. All of them, it's because they don't work hard. It is too simplistic.
But that's both are correct. Both of you are right, you
see. It's like saying that sexism doesn't exist.
Let me count
this. I didn't say
this. Drink water.
Because you have a black president in America, racism does not exist.
And did I say racism doesn't exist?
And the structures.
Hold on. You know what's happening these days in Ghana? A lot of people in Europe, Ghanaians and abroad, are bringing their children, their teenage children, to schools in Ghana to make it better for them to get into the Oxford and the Cambridges. Because if you're coming out of England, they feel that it's more difficult to get into Oxford and Cambridge if you went to study in England as a black person. But if you were coming from Ghana, you're more likely to get in. You're shaking your head. You don't agree with that?
But everything in this life is not about
racism. Did you do secondary
racism.
School in England?
I did. I even did junior school in England.
Junior school in England?
I did junior school. I did most of my secondary school in England.
Did you live in an elite place?
Well, we moved around.
What does that mean?
We moved around. I
mean, were your parents rich?
We were a nice middle class.
Nice middle class, and you were African
people. But you know
what?
I resent this line of question because you know what? One thing I know for sure, you know, Oprah has that saying where she's, you know, things I know for sure. Mm. One thing I know for sure is that people who are more threatening in terms of, you're saying, well, there's few black people in bar school, etc., etc., in England. No offense, they go after those people more than a whole bunch of people who they don't feel threatened by.
You mean the racism?
So the argument is...
What I wanted to say, going back to what Felicity said, I more inclined to agree with Felicity as opposed to Amanda, because you see, probably the reason why they will say black people are aggressive is that, you see, in the fight for your will, the fight for freedom as we know it, it comes with a level of aggression. See, even in Ghana history, why is red, gold, green? What does red represent?
The blood.
Thank you. Mm. You see, when you feel you're in the minority,
we have to fight
sometimes
for it.
Diplomacy doesn't cut it out.
Yeah.
So you need to push. You need to work hard. Sometimes you need to work so many times as hard as somebody else. Now, if you come from a background, you're Ghanaian. Yes, you're Ghanaian, middle class, probably a diplomat. You travel around a lot. You have all these privileges. Mm-hmm. You don't enter into that world as an underprivileged person. So to start with, your life can start on a good note. Now listen, for people who own their self-worth and know what power they have, it's because they have mastery over their emotional intelligence. You see, and that doesn't come from fighting on the streets. It comes from a certain level of exposure, a certain level of learning, you know. So people who are able to hold themselves and block out all these negativities is because they are so emotionally intelligent, they're able to choose what to react to and what not to react to. Or they have the power within themselves in that they are learning, they are progressing, they are achieving. But just think about those people who don't have those opportunities. Yeah, for instance, they have systems where you go to community schools. Now, the kind of schools that are in the communities of the black people are not schools, and me, I wouldn't send my child there. I wouldn't.
Good. Great.
Amanda, do you recognize that?
I will.
In England and America,
so you realize that
you have to go to a community school.
A community school.
If you don't have enough money to pay big rent, you have to be in a community school.
But this Ben Carson example, is that the Ben Carson?
No, that's only one. They pick one.
That's not the same. No, listen. He picked himself.
Amanda, I think that he picked himself by working extremely hard. No, listen.
He picked himself.
Those are talking.
Listen. Amanda, listen. Forget about Ben Carson. Look, to every rule, there's an exception.
So when you make yourself the exception,
but if you make yourself the exception, that's when it aggregates.
Why are we here? Because Madden wrote her own narrative.
Yeah.
You write your own narrative in life. You can't let people fool you.
No, but Amanda, listen. Why can't I be a listener of Agbaja and Bobobo and still get my interview and still get the job I'm looking for? Why do I have to listen to classical music?
No, I'm just saying, that was just one example.
I'm trying to say, in order to win the racism, whatever.
You create your own box.
You create your own box. And that involves mirroring them.
Yeah,
so, for instance, you need to walk like them.
You need to talk like them.
Were you born in Ghana?
Yeah.
No, I was born in another African
country. Why should they be born in another African country? But listen, why is it that you were born in Ghana? Probably some people have been bred in Ghana till secondary school.
Yeah.
Then they travel, they go to school for 4 years, they come back, and they have an accent that can never be changed back to Ghanaian accent. Why? All I'm trying to say is that in order to sound sensible, in order to sound like you have achieved, you need to mirror them in order to be able to get into
I agree with that, that's correct.
And that
that's
is correct. The fact. Mm-hmm. So that's where racism comes in. But, and you see, when you ask me that, is racism only... Look,
but is it mirroring them or learning what is good?
No, it's about learning what is good.
Yeah.
Listen, but it's about mirroring them.
I like to wear a suit.
Wait, hold on, that's copying England. My sister,
but I don't do drugs.
My sister lives, some British do. Hold on. My sister lives in England and she lives in a very predominantly white area. Mm-hmm. In fact, the day I went to visit her, I go to the train station, I sat in the cab. The cab just started going. I'm like, where are you going to? He said, I'm taking you to that address, because they knew exactly. That's the only black person in the whole community.
Oh, wow.
Now, in her office place, she has issues like people asking her, why do you speak different? It's like, so she needs to...
Her accent is different.
Yeah, her accent is different. And she's been there for years. And she's tried as much as possible not to just adapt the accent for adapting's sake, you understand? And people question why her accent isn't changing. We can't understand you if you speak like that. We can't do this if you speak like that. You see,
but that's not racism.
No, it's not racism, but I'm saying that in a very subtle way. No, listen.
When a British comes here, we can't hear what he's saying.
No, we can't hear what he says, but we don't force him to change the way he speaks. Look, I would probably rather call someone like, what is he saying? No, translate it to me. Can you break it down for me?
Yeah.
But I don't make the person feel like what you're saying is not acceptable. And even at her workplace,
she's
qualified, she's good, she's everything. But the question is that when it comes to her remuneration, does she get the same as her colleague, white person? No. You see, so these are
so
systemic
things. So you know what
things.
You do? You create now, your own on, business. No, you create no, your own business, no, listen, you move listen, forward, listen. You do your
everybody
own
is an entrepreneur. No, everybody no, creates no. their own business. Who's going to work for you? Now, secondly, now when it comes to even Ghana and Africa, trust me, look, racism exists in all levels. Look,
for all human beings.
All
no,
human
that's
beings.
An important point.
Even, in,
power
even in Ghana. Oh, may even I, in may Ghana. I, here, may
I look, about tribalism, you mean?
No, not even tribalism. Even in Ghana here. Even in Ghana here. There was a time where being fair was considered superior over
oh,
being
no,
black.
It's not, it's
oh,
not,
it's still,
no,
it's still,
no, I'm saying that
it's still
is.
Is.
No.
It still is.
No, listen,
it's very
listen.
Is. It's for women, you mean?
Yeah, for women. For women.
For men as well.
No, for women. For women. We're being fair. Mm-hmm. So you realize that there was a particular dispensation where most of the quote-unquote celebrities
were bleaching
and doing
still,
around
still
this.
Still
well, if I say they are
we
still
laugh at
are
them,
you,
but they are still doing
yeah,
it.
But you ask me for examples, I wouldn't
no,
really
I
give examples.
Ask you
okay, fantastic. So the thing is that even amongst us, and you know when you go to places like India, we have the caste system. Mm-hmm. Where the fair is considered superior over the black.
And it's See, all rooted all, in racism.
It's all rooted in racism. Yeah. And it's all,
just,
it's all rooted in racism.
We are coming from
but
a 600-year powerful history.
Understand. Yeah. So we have powerful
we were
history.
You know, Kanye
we have
from, we were kings and queens.
Listen,
just
we have
not
listen.
Everybody was.
No, listen.
Was
we have game changers. We have game
changers.
So I just want to take make an important point. About, you know, there were laws that were made that made sure black people remained black. I think that's what we forget. That prevented them from owning homes in certain areas.
Yes,
in America.
It is. Yes.
That is why.
There are certain
yes.
areas.
So,
yeah, but
even,
they are no longer
even,
there.
Yes, but then, you see, it is built on 400-year system. That's why somebody, I've forgotten who said this, that, you know, you practice racism for 400 years and expect that people will become would have the reverse of it in 50 years.
Exactly.
That's
it's not possible.
You use 400 years
no,
to
but that's what that man doesn't want to hear. That's a damning statement.
No,
that we are doomed to suffer another
no,
one.
No, we are not doomed.
No.
It's a process.
Create your own reality.
It is
life.
A process.
That's
what
I believe in.
And there's somebody who went for an interview and said, use the name Emily Blunt, and was called for an interview. Oh, you're the one. Meanwhile, she could have used Jamal or Bridget or Asantewaa, but she had to use Emily Blunt to get an interview. Because if they knew she was black, she wouldn't have been invited.
I don't know. Have you seen the story of Chimamanda?
Yes.
Of course.
Yes. But
yes.
Chimamanda tells you that
she's
it's not
amazing.
About the name. She has a heavy Nigerian name.
Yes, but
the, she's
oh,
made it everywhere.
How many
you create your
own. I agree with you.
How many
Chimamanda do you
have?
That's why I agree with you. How
you know,
many
but you see, to be.
There are brilliant people and people who make it to the top.
But Chimamanda comes from an elite Nigerian family.
Yes, and you know what?
To say that everybody else that's not at the top is because they haven't worked as hard as the people at the top.
I
because
agree.
That is not true.
I anybody
because
who
hard
makes
work,
it
hard work
has
and
an authentic
don't
voice.
Always go hand in hand.
No, anybody
because
who makes
if
it has
hard
an
work
voice.
Is what makes you excel. The average African woman should be the richest woman in the world because they are working.
Last one that I need to end.
I
so this professor told me that I told her that well, you have to create your own story, like Amanda is saying. If America is not accepting you in a global world, move to Ghana, move to Nigeria, move to Kenya. And she said to me that that's still a luxury. There are people in America who are not educated enough to know that they can move.
Exactly.
Who don't have a penny. They've never climbed an aeroplane, staircased into an aeroplane before.
Oh, no,
and the structure
course.
Keeps them there in America.
But Paul,
and that's,
Paul,
that was
fly
sad.
Out of the cage.
Paul.
You know what I mean?
Fly out of the cage.
When fly out of the cage of your mind.
That's where
I mean.
Okay, and that's where going back to this Megan.
Yeah,
okay, final comments for everyone.
This idea that, oh, if America is racist, just move to Ghana. Even me coming, having a British accent, and Amanda will attest to this, that is even a privilege in Ghana within itself.
Yeah.
We must admit that even people, we who have British accents that live in Ghana, we are also treated differently.
We are treated better?
Yes.
By men or women?
Both.
Everybody.
I go to an institution, I don't speak, they're treating me a certain way. When I open my mouth to speak English, their behavior completely changes sometimes. I'm not joking.
Yeah.
Even that is a privilege within itself. So all these things are... So if I'm not going to admit that, oh, even that is a privilege, I have to acknowledge that privilege.
Yeah.
I have to acknowledge it. It doesn't make me a bad person to have that privilege, but I must acknowledge that I have
what
that privilege.
What do you
privilege.
Use that privilege for?
Yes, I have to ensure that I don't use it to oppress others. It's important for me to recognize that I have that privilege and not say that, oh, I shouldn't... When I go for a job interview, maybe I'm chosen over somebody else. I don't say it's because, oh, I'm the best. I should recognize that maybe if I'm just being chosen because I have a British accent and how that could be wrong. I should be calling out the system, not just saying that, well, I have a British accent, so just let me in. No.
Do you want to lose your British accent?
I can speak in a Ghanaian accent. I can do both.
So if you can do Ghanaian accent, why are you doing British accent tonight?
No, because
tonight?
That's what comes naturally to me. That's what comes naturally to me.
Do you want
to
lose it?
Do I want to lose it?
Yes.
That's what comes
so that
out.
You're more Ghanaian, so you talk
in
like
my
I'm
mind,
now,
in my
yeah.
mind, I think in an English accent, if that makes sense. I
yeah.
think any
oh, language okay. is
yeah, so that's what comes naturally. That's my first language.
So you say like in it?
I never say in it, but yes.
Your last comment, Bridges.
No, I just want to say that nothing was handed to anybody. Mm-hmm. For change to happen, you'd have to fight for it. And it takes a lot of work and numbers to have that done. So yes, if you see something happening elsewhere, don't say it's not your country and so you won't. You should add your voice, whatever platform you have, and hope to God that when that change happens, its rippling effect would affect all of us. That's all I want to say.
Rosina?
What I'll say is that racism exists. I mean, yeah. in Ghana, and what Megan is going through has been escalated probably because she's also black or has some bit of black in there, whether it's 1/16th or 1/8th. Yeah,
on,
there's still
black.
Something in there. Yeah, she's considered black. So that's the reality on the ground. Culture also plays a bit because culture comes from centuries of, people living in a particular way. And for you to change mindsets, it's as slow as it began. You understand? So sometimes it takes either a radical force to change mindsets or a deliberate attempt slowly to change those mindsets. And that's when you have people who are willing to just block out all those negative comments, negative sentiments, and do the best for themselves. And I think that in some way, Megan has tried to do some of that because she entered. I'm sure the reason why she went into that house, that palace, was because she felt she was strong enough to deal with it. She felt she could handle it, but she realized that she really couldn't handle it. So she had to really come out and then tell people a bit about what is going on and then probably prevent other people from making the same mistakes.
Amanda, last comment?
Yeah. I think racism is very real, and I'm very happy that Megan spoke her truth and mm-hmm. she was authentic. But I'm a strong believer that one creates their own reality in life. And when the voice inside of you becomes louder than the noise around you, I really think that you begin to master your life. And everybody's been mentioning a lot of things about people who made it, people who made it. And a lot of people, even me. I mean, when I was in school, I went to school here for 2 years. Nobody thought I'd be a lawyer or could see my path, et cetera, et cetera. But the point is, I saw myself as that. And I really think that there's a lot of power in seeing yourself as something and working towards that. And so racism is real, and you would be living in a glass house if you didn't think it was real. But mastering one's life is really about that voice inside you being louder than all that noise and jazz and racism outside you, because anybody can make it in this world. And everybody who speaks with an authentic voice always makes it. Like, that's why you have different types of writings, you have different types of presenters, you have different types of everything. Because once a whole bunch of people look at that person and they're like, okay, that's authentic, somehow the energy starts coming towards them. So racism is very real, but if we're going to build ourselves as people within Ghana and outside Ghana, we really do have to master our own voice.
Amanda Clinton, a barrister at law, and Rosina Kwakume is a banker and also a social commentator. Bridget Otu is a controversial journalist. Felicity Nelson is a journalist with a British accent.